Alright, you know roughly how triggers work, but we haven't seen how to make an entity usable by the player, and that's what we're gonna do today. Oh, and not just that, we're also gonna do take damage. So let's start from the beginning. How does the player actually use other entities? It's simple. Every frame, the player basically checks if the use key was pressed, and if it was, it searches for the nearest entity via some algorithm. And if it can be used, it calls the use method. Now, how does it check if it can be used? Well, it checks these FCAP flags. They specify the type of player usage, among other things. If the entity we're looking at has the continuous use flag, it's going to be triggered every frame so long as the use key is held down. If it has the impulse use flag, it's going to be triggered only once, until the player lets go of the key and presses it again. If it's not obvious to you, this continuous use flag is set by these rotating valves. Buttons, doors, and a bunch of other stuff generally sets the impulse use flag. You can set these flags by overriding the object caps method. I guess it means object capabilities. And there, that's pretty much it. If you peek the definition of this flag, you'll see that there are many more. You can even add your own if you wish and define your own functionality for them, but that's out of scope for this tutorial. I really hope you understand basic bitwise operations like AND, OR, and others, because you'll need them whenever you work with flags. Continuous use is the same, you just gotta use a different flag. So with that out of the way, let's do take damage. Inflictor is the entity that inflicted damage to this entity, and it's kinda similar to pcaller in the use method. In practice, this is often a rocket or a grenade or some falling rock, perhaps a train controlled by a player which managed to crush this entity and so on. Attacker is the entity that is considered to have the intent of killing this entity. In other words, it's similar to activator in the use method. And in practice, this is usually the player or NPCs. And of course, sometimes the inflictor and the attacker are the same entity, like when a zombie strikes someone, the zombie is the inflictor and the attacker at the same time. And FL damage is obviously the amount of damage that is intended to be dealt. Bits damage type contains flags that tell us more about the type of the attack. For example, whether the damage comes from an explosion or bullets or drowning. And this is pretty much how the Gargantua monster implements bulletproof armor. Or in the helicopter's case, it's just gonna multiply it by like, what, 1%? I don't know, I don't remember. And yes, you can define your own damage types too. You can see that this method returns some number, an integer to be precise. But this is usually 1 or 0, indicating that damage was either taken or not taken respectively. So let's do something with this. Let's write a brush entity that can be shot and repaired, either by using it or by whacking it with a crowbar. Come on, I think that's a fun idea. So first, you need a spawn method to set some things in it. You will need to set pev take damage to true, so the entity can be damaged. Also, you'll need to set pev health to 100 so we have something to work with. Also, you will obviously override object caps and add the impulse use flag. Then override use and take damage. In use, we'll basically increment pev health by 5. If health is bigger than 100, simply set it back to 100. We're simply clamping it that way. In take damage, we will simply reduce pev health by FL damage. However, what about repairing it by whacking it with a crowbar? Well, we first gotta figure out what makes the crowbar's damage unique so we can actually check for it, I mean identify it. If you go over to crowbar.cpp, you'll see in the attack code that it calls trace attack with the damage club damage type. No other weapon seems to use that. So, you can simply check if bit's damage type has damage club in it, and if so, add FL damage to pev health instead of subtracting from it. Finally, we can add some aesthetics. If the entity is damaged, it may emit sparks from its origin. The frequency of this sparking will depend directly on the entity's health. For example, if pev health is 10, it'll spark every 0.1 seconds, and if it's 20, it sparks every 0.2 seconds. So, you can kinda see that the lower the health is, the faster the sparking, and vice versa. So, instead of doing a bunch of if-else statements for a lengthy switch case, let's just figure out a relationship between these two numbers. Obviously, 0.1 is 100 times smaller than 10, and 0.2 is also 100 times smaller than 10. If we keep plotting out these numbers, you're gonna notice a pattern. Every one of these is 100 times smaller than its corresponding health value, so all we gotta do is divide health by 100 whenever we wanna add the time for the next thing. So, PevNext Stink is gonna be current time plus health divided by 100. It's pretty simple. The bigger the divisor is, the faster it's gonna spark. Bigger the health, the slower it's gonna spark. And that's pretty much it. Well, this was a bit of a short one, so that's kinda nice. Doing all the work for one of these typically takes like 3 to 4 days, but I got a lot of projects to work on besides these tutorials. I got this one called Nail and Crescent, which is like a Quake 2 RTX thing, but it's a Quake 1, you know. I got Brick Deck, which is my own engine. I got Half-Life ADM, which is my Half-Life mod base. I got DK Solo Mission, a mod I'm working on with Mr. Floyd. You get the point, I got like hundreds of these. Okay, not hundreds, but you know. Anyway, there will be another tutorial like this by the end of the month about modular entity functions, and in September we're gonna do some cool stuff with entity key values and finding entities by name and triggering them or doing anything else we wanna do with them. And hopefully I'll talk about my uploading schedule, then some statistics and future ideas and a very rough time estimate for each chapter, which is bound to change anyway. But the point is, there's lots of stuff I wanna talk about and too little time to do so. So until then, happy programming!